And now we're going to bring in everybody, the composer of God of War Ragnarok. Please, everybody, welcome Bear McCreary.
Hey.
Hey, Bear.
How's it going?
Good. How are you doing?
Oh, man, I'm doing great.
Good. Great to see you again. Like the outfit change. Looking good.
Got to look nice and metal for Ragnarok, bro.
That's right. Hell yeah. So, Bear, I wanted to kick this off with just getting to know you a little bit, getting to know your career, and kind of diving into the beginnings of how this all came together. For you personally, I'm wondering how you fell, not just into video game scoring, but just into scoring in general, because I know you've had a lot of crazy projects over the years, but what went off in your brain to start scoring for films, TV, movies, and games?
I wanted to write music for media since I was about 5 years old or six. I've been doomed ever since then to be a soundtrack nerd and maybe even a composer. I think I've always loved the interplay between music and melody and emotion and story. Mm-hmm. So I always loved movies and television and games. And in video games, over the course of my childhood, as I grew up, I was the exact age where video games grew up with me. Mm-hmm. When I was five, games were meant for five-year-olds. When I was 13, games were starting to come out for 13-year-olds. And when I was a teenager, that just the art form kept evolving. And interestingly, I felt that the story in games began to be something that really became sophisticated in the late 90s in particular. I mean, earlier than that, obviously, but really like cinematic storytelling with games like Metal Gear Solid really showed that the medium was capable of more than maybe people thought. So, you know, you fast forward another couple of years, I my career started in television, writing music for a television show called Battlestar Galactica, and did a lot of movies and then started to get to do some video games. And they had stories, real stories, with incredible performances and incredible writing. And so I was thrilled to be a part of God of War, the 2018 game. And I feel like, you know, maybe we've all hopefully upped the ante for God of War Ragnarok.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you mentioned a lot of cool stuff there that I want to break down. But first, I think your entry point was really cool in that you always had a vision for that. And I want to know from a young age, what kind of music were you really into? Because, of course, the stuff you make in a lot of instances is very, like, epic, over-the-top, orchestral, lots of different instruments working together. But are there any other genres that maybe influence that or kind of help you along the way with some inspiration?
When I was a kid, I listened to nothing but movie music.
Wow.
I didn't listen to anything else. And my heroes were all film composers. Mm-hmm. Jerry Goldsmith, Danny Elfman, Alan Silvestri, Elmer Bernstein, John Williams, James Horner, Basil Poledouris, Ennio Morricone, Nino Rota. These were my rock stars. Mm-hmm. And then in many ways, it was like they led me to other genres of music that have also gone on to influence me later in life. Through Danny Elfman, I found Oingo Boingo, which became like pop music. Through Ennio Morricone, I heard that this band always played the Ecstasy of Gold at the beginning of their concerts, Metallica. Mm-hmm. Through Michael Kamen's score for Highlander, I also heard these amazing songs by Queen. And I saw like Pink Floyd's The Wall. So there was like rock and roll. Especially big narrative rock and roll was also always part of what I loved, but I got into it later after I had really solidified my love of orchestral music. The reason I bring all that up is I think you can hear that in Kratos's music to a certain degree, this very simple, heavy, brooding, boom, bum, bum, bum. It almost has this like metal emotion to it, which I think is cool.
Yeah, it's very, it really reads symphonic power metal sometimes too when you're in those moments. Like I'm a big fan of like power metal. I love all kinds of metal. And especially kind of what you mentioned there, that the three note progression that you really get, and you really set the tone for Kratos, and you really follow him through the story with, you know, sometimes it's more aggressive and sometimes it's lighter, and depending on the emotions and the mood of everything. And I definitely want to get into all that, but to kind of take us back to the beginning a little more too, your entry point into video games, what was that time period like? What was the industry like at that point? And getting into it, what did it do? Because I know video game composition has become so crazy lately. I mean, there are all these, I mean, look at God of War Ragnarok, right? There are all these games with insane compositions for them as compared to older compositions that were kind of like a, okay, we finished the game, let's put some background music on it, you know? So for you getting into the industry, how did that happen? What was your entry point into video games specifically?
My first video game was a game for Capcom in the late 2010s, 2000s, called Dark Void.
Cool.
And Dark Void was a big symphonic epic score. And I was hired on it because of my work on Battlestar Galactica. That was my first job. I know I mentioned it before, but all roads kind of go back to Battlestar for me, because it put me on the map. I was 24 or 25 when I started that show. And then my first game was Dark Void. And the same year or a year later, I did my first Sony project, which was SOCOM 4, US Navy SEALs. And in fact, it was that game that connected me with the Sony music department, who brought me in on God of War for what would become the 2018 game. But in both cases, I was brought in, I think, because of this symphonic kind of Hollywood lyrical expressive sound that I had applied to Battlestar Galactica, though in a very strange way. Battlestar was built around a lot of tribal percussion and Japanese percussion.
Right.
But it had some melodies. I got some melodies in there. And Dark Void was sort of my first big swing at writing something epic and symphonic in the style of, in particular, Elmer Bernstein, who was my mentor personally. I knew him for about 10 years, and he was one of the great film composers of all time. So games, for me, were always an extension of cinematic storytelling. It was a thrill getting to be involved in adaptive music, but I never really asked how game music was made. All I knew is as a gamer what I wanted. So I remember in my early meetings on both those games, I was so excited and naive, really. I sat down and I said, hey, what if we could do this? What if we could do that? Could the music evolve this way? What if we had different splits to do it this way? Can you run the reverb on your processor so that like we could do edits before the reverb? And everyone was like, no, but maybe we could. And in fact, with SOCOM, they dove in headfirst. And a lot of the ideas that I was pitching them, not only did we accomplish, but they rewrote the audio engine that became the standard Sony audio engine moving forward. And in fact, on God of War and on God of War Ragnarok, I love working with Sony in particular because they embrace that forward-thinking philosophy. And every time I come in daydreaming about ways the music could be implemented that are, and I'm saying it as a gamer, I don't hear this. When I play a game, I don't, there's things I don't hear. How can we do it? And they're ready to dive in. So in many ways, Sony and I were, I think, a perfect fit philosophically in that way.
Yeah, definitely. It's really cool how they kind of saw your vision and let you do what you want as well. And they were able to be flexible with, I don't know, what you as a fan would like to see in gaming and what you as a fan would like to see in the future of music and compositions in gaming.
I have always approached everything with a childlike naivete. When I started scoring TV, I didn't go ask how to score TV. I just suddenly found myself scoring Battlestar Galactica. And I thought, I want to write the coolest music I can imagine. I want it to sound like a big epic movie. I have to do it 20 times in a year, but I'll just figure it out. had I asked around, I might have had my spirits dampened. And the same thing with games. Like I walked in to meetings and people have said, well, you know, can you deliver a stereo file with loop points? And I go, well, yeah, but what if we ... do this? Let's expand this. Can we run stems? What if, you know, it's all about that collaboration in games more than anything else. You've got to work with a team that can facilitate your vision and make it work for the player, because it doesn't matter how great the music is. If it's not implemented well, you're not going to have the experience that you want.
Mm-hmm. And to reach that kind of perfect music that you want to reach for each franchise, what does your setup look like? What is your approach to starting a project? Because I know you're in your studio right now, but I've also seen you in front of orchestras conducting. So when you start on a project, when you get a project, how do you begin? Where do the first ideas tend to come from?
I always begin with character and story. Mm-hmm. And my adventure on God of War began with that, when Corey Barlog met with me very early, I think before I was even hired. He met with me early and told me the story of this father and his son and their estranged relationship, and that they were taking the ashes of the boy's mother to the highest peak in all the realms. And immediately my imagination is firing up with emotion and shapes and moods. I always start with themes, always, always, always. I want to have a theme that tells you something about the story if you played it with one finger on the piano. For games, that's my entry point, but I tend to be hired on games that have a lot of narrative built into them. You know, like I haven't done music for like a FIFA game or something like that. I wouldn't know how to do that just because it's like almost a different thing. For me, it's the story.
Right.
And it just so happens that it's in an interactive medium, but it's a story nonetheless.
Yeah. Walk me through, since we're talking about God of War, walk me through how you started to get in contact with Corey Balrog and started to get integrated into God of War, and maybe even your first day on the job working for the 2018 version.
My friends at Sony called me in to a meeting there. This was after we had done SOCOM 4. Mm-hmm. And they just started asking me some questions about Norse music. I said, I play hurdy-gurdy, which is common from that area. I know a little bit about nickel harpa. Mm-hmm. And they asked me a little bit about choirs. And I went, I love writing for choirs. They asked me a little bit about mythology. And I said, yeah, I mean, I'd love to know more. Then they asked me one other thing, like, but also maybe percussion for something with like a lot of action. And I went, guys, are you making a new God of War? And the room went silent. they were like, ooh. And I knew, I was like, oh my God. And then they were like, all right, we'll tell you. Yes.
Oh my God.
And I think later that same day I met Corey. Mm-hmm. Corey came in. And it was sort of love at first sight. I don't know how else to describe it. I mean, mm-hmm. Corey, I think we talked for 3 hours. He might have walked me through the game. Corey is one of my favorite storytellers. If I ever go camping, I would want Corey around the fire telling me a story, because he can make it real and make it emotional. So that was how we started. And my first day on the job was writing music for what would become the E3 2016 gameplay reveal.
Yeah, right.
It wasn't that at the time. The game wasn't even greenlit yet. So there was no game. It was like in an exploratory phase. And they hired me to develop some ideas. And we decided to throw out everything that you would expect and write a score that was intimate and folky and raw and emotional. So I brought in a tiny little ensemble. Nordic folk instruments, Hardanger fiddle, nickel harpa, hurdy-gurdy, like one drummer. And I wrote a theme for the game, which was like going to be the Kratos theme. Mm-hmm. And it was very sad. Da 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 da. And everybody loved it. It was great. Game got greenlit. We moved into development. And as the game went along, I started writing other themes. Mm-hmm. And eventually, Corey and the other developers came back and said that that theme isn't strong enough. We realized, like, with all this combat and Kratos still, he still is the same person. He's running from his past. We need something that's a little more muscular. We got to throw that out. And I was like, okay, let's try something else. And then I sketched out what became the God of War theme for 2018, Kratos's theme. But I always remembered that. I always remembered that lovely, sad melody. Mm-hmm. And at some point in the development process, without telling them, I brought it back in as a theme for Atreus's mother. What if there were two themes? For this is about a boy who's torn between his parents. I've got a strong theme for the father. What if that melody that I originally wrote, inspired by the story Corey was telling me, what if that's her theme? And I brought it back in, and it went off great. Everybody loved it. And I never asked them if they remembered that they had specifically instructed me to throw it away. I didn't want to call them on it, but there it was, you know, no good idea gets thrown away.
It's like one parent saying no and going to the other parent and them saying yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's great.
I mean, yeah. And of course, in fairness, they were correct. That wasn't a good theme to signify Kratos specifically, but in contrast, mm-hmm. it's quite fantastic. Mm. And then over the course of that game, those two themes cross paths. And of course, Kratos's theme can become very warm and fatherly. And her theme, especially when sung by Ivor, can be very powerful and piercing. And of course, by the end of the game, I won't spoil it, I guess, but, you know, we find out some things about the mother and that empower her. We learn an evolution of Kratos. You know, we learn that he evolves, that makes him a warmer figure. So those themes are able to kind of cross-pollinate in a way that's really cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and from kind of the contrast of this game, I thought it was pretty fantastic how you had those Kratos very aggressive hits, but also at the same time you have, like, you know, memories of mother, like a very more sad and introspective track. I think from the first installment of the series, the first three games, you know, there was a little bit of that, but I felt like with the 2018 version, they really sunk into the storytelling a little more, especially with, like, having a son and everything. For you entering the project, did you, especially growing up with video games, as you said, did you play the first three God of Wars? Did you have any opinions on the soundtrack of those? And was there any ideas on that you had about, okay, like, maybe how do I continue it or how do I change it to make it better fit this iteration of God of War?
I did play the games. They were really fun. Yeah. To me, they were the crown jewel, the height of the arcade style button masher, fixed camera. Mm-hmm. I'm sure someone will comment and correct me, but a major franchise like that being a fixed camera combat game after God of War all felt like they were imitating God of War. Like, in a way, that sort of brawler style game reached its apex in God of War,
yeah.
But it was an older style game. Mm-hmm. There's no denying it. And so I liked it. And I loved the absurdity of the over the top, like, violence and excess. But at that time, I mean, I already mentioned, Metal Gear Solid. I mean, for me, like, around that time, Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater came out. I played that game over and over and over, and I cried at the end. Like, those were the kinds of games that pulled me in emotionally. And so for me, I never adored the original God of War games. I thought they were really fun, but I didn't replay them the way I replayed Uncharted and Uncharted 2, which I think is a masterpiece of cinematic gameplay. And so I had discussions with Corey, God of War 2018, whether or not we were referencing the old themes. And experimented with it. Mm-hmm. But we ultimately decided it wasn't the way to go. That it actually triggered so many memories of who he was. It was almost doing the story a disservice. You know, it might have been different if we had seen visual flashbacks or something, but you know, it's so long ago and he's such a different person that we ultimately just made the decision not to quote it. And I thought the scores were awesome. I mean, they were so big and they sounded Greek. They had those cool Mediterranean harmonies. They were cool, you know, but the whole game was like an assault on your senses. I mean, it was like, It was like the Spinal Tap turned to 11 all the way, which was its appeal. And I found the 2018 game, you know, to be much more in line, obviously, with a game like The Last of Us or Uncharted.
Right.
And if anything, I think it improved on those formats because those games are fantastic, but they're very cinematic. Mm-hmm. And I feel like only recently have games figured out how to be cinematic narratively and emotionally, but also great games mm-hmm. with great mechanics and great feel. And if anything, like the fact that God of War, I've seen YouTube videos going on and on for 45 minutes just about the mechanics of playing without mentioning the cinematics and the music and the acting and the writing and the single camera move and vice versa. Mm-hmm. I've seen videos talking about nothing but that, ignoring the incredible gameplay. So I think that Santa Monica Studio really kind of struck gold in the design of God of War 2018. And it was the byproduct of decades of games building to this. Look, and I'm biased. I worked on it. And people are going to comment and say, what about this? And what about this? And what about this? And yes, I'm not aware of every game that's out there. But I think God of War 2018 deserved the praise that it got. And I'm very grateful to have been able to contribute a little bit to it.
Yeah, definitely what you said. I think it was a nice, fresh start to the series. And I think it really helped usher in kind of that new area for the series, especially being in Scandinavia. I think that was an exceptionally interesting part of the whole thing and switching from Greek gods because, you know, they were all dead at that point canon to now Norse gods and to kind of figuring that stuff out. And for you, I know you speak about having a little experience in knowing a little bit of Norse mythology, knowing a little bit about some traditional Scandinavian instruments. But for you, what was your research phase like, especially with the choirs and talking about like language to give them and how they express themselves on the tracks? Just talk to me about the research and how that maybe influenced the music that you ended up producing.
I always like to take on jobs that let me learn something that I don't know anything about. Mm-hmm. And I knew a little bit about Norse mythology and Northern European folk music, but not that much. So I began a deep dive. I always start with finding musicians and scholars, but in particular, people that actually play instruments and get to know them so they can teach me what the instrument does traditionally, why it does it. I like to learn all the rules so that I can knowingly break some of them. In with regards to the language, we really came across a fantastic discovery. We wanted the languages to be sung in Old Norse. And in many ways, we wanted not just music. I think I'm speaking for Corey and the design team. The game wanted to feel older than Vikings. Viking is actually newer mm-hmm. than the source of the myths. And so it's not a Viking design, which I think you can see in the visuals. And I wanted to honor that in the music as well. So Old Norse is an ancient language that is understood and can be spoken today. But in Iceland, the Icelandic language, because of their geographical isolation, their language is still similar enough that an Icelandic speaker can read Old Norse and pronounce it correctly. So this meant if we recorded choirs in Iceland, that we could actually just show them the text and they would know exactly how to pronounce it. We wouldn't have to learn each syllable painstakingly and have them learn it phonetically. So that was awesome. We worked with a choir on the first game called Schola Cantorum. They are sort of a national choir in Iceland. It's not a very Hollywood sound because they literally have never played, they have never sung on a film or television or game score before. Wow. And so they have this really unique pronunciation, and they're a small group. There's not a lot of them. Because it's Iceland, it's a small country. But they were a big part of the defining sound of God of War 2018. We brought many of them back for Ragnarok, augmented with even more Icelandic singers. We did up the scale, but we still recorded choir in Iceland. And we also brought in a solo singer, Ivor, from the Faroese Islands. Her language is very similar too. She sang Memories of Mother that you mentioned. And she does these other interesting grunting vocalizations. She's sort of the musical voice of Atreus's mother. But that was all in an effort to lend authenticity to the sound. I wanted this to be instrumentalists and performers from throughout Northern Europe that really had something to say with their instruments and with their voices.
Really cool. Somebody had a question in the chat for, I think, everybody else, but I want to direct it at you too. So during this point, did you travel to Iceland? Did you also travel anywhere else for the production of this game?
I did go to Iceland.
Cool.
I went to Iceland for the recording of God of War 2018. Mm-hmm. I would have loved to have gone for the research phase. It just didn't work out. But I did work with a lot of players who were there and got to know them and worked with them remotely. Cool. But to go physically in 2017, I guess I would have gone, was magical. I adored it. And I walked around Reykjavik on my days off. I put in my earbuds and downloaded local Icelandic metal bands and just walked around listening to them. Nice. In fact, I found a band called Ham, capital H, capital A, capital M.
Oh, yes.
So great. So great. I actually track down the singer. I'm working with him on a project
now. Oh, so cool.
Just because, like, walking around there, you're like in this place and their music is so cool. Mm-hmm. It was like, I don't know how to describe it. I just felt like absorbing the power, you know? And I saw the glaciers and I went to the hot springs and all this stuff.
Cool.
And I definitely channeled that into God of War Ragnarok, because when I wrote Ragnarok, I had my memories of having gone there. I also went to London to record. I conducted the 2018 score, in London. That was amazing. Those trips were fantastic. I'll never forget it.
That's awesome. I had somebody else in the chat, which, by the way, anybody, if you have questions, feel free to drop them in. Krukus, actually. How much of an impact did the reception of your live performance at E3 for the God of War soundtrack make on you?
My live performance for God of War at E3 2016 is a contender for the greatest moment of my entire life. I don't want to say it'll never be topped, but that was absolutely incredible. God of War had not been announced. I think a couple of images had leaked. I think people knew it was in development, but at E3 2016 at the Shrine Auditorium, press and gamers came in and there was an orchestra in the pit. So they knew they were getting something. And you could say that the new franchise was announced when I walked out. Nobody knew what I was even doing there. And I started playing this music that no one had ever heard. I'm not playing the hits. I'm not playing old themes. I'm playing this new theme. Bum, 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 bum. And it's not a short piece. It's like a 4-minute overture. And then the curtains open and the gameplay begins. And with a little tease, we see Atreus. Then we finally see Kratos. And those three notes come back, bum, 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 solidifying that, yeah, that's what you were hearing. And the crowd, I felt this electrical jolt through my skin. I couldn't see anybody. I was facing the screen. But it was incredible. And I was actually conducting real time while Corey was playing. It was not a trailer. It was gameplay in real time, which is the most daring thing you could have done at that point. And it was incredible. I don't know if I'll ever forget it or ever top it. I mean, that I felt at that point that Sony had faith in me that they could announce this franchise with the music coming first, that the music was good enough that fans would pay attention for 4 minutes without knowing what it is. I thought that was so cool. I'll never forget it.
A beautiful moment. Definitely. And watching it on YouTube, like, is crazy. Some people are talking about, they get chills from it. Like, I get the same. It's like a really awesome moment. And I want to ladder that into talking about Ragnarok a little bit, because, you know, Ragnarok comes out in about a week, a little less than a week right now. For that game, what was the process of getting into that one, right? You've already had your first rodeo. You worked on God of War 2018. Being brought in for that project, did you know that you were going to be on it for a while? Was it something that was in the pipeline for you? When did you start working on it, and how did you begin?
I have been on God of War Ragnarok in an official capacity for over 3 years, 3.5 years, which comes out to about as long as I was on the first God of War. I might have been on God of War 2018 for one additional year because I came in before it was greenlit. But certainly with the game being in actual production, that 3.5 year lifespan between me starting my first idea and the game being on shelves, it holds. And with God of War Ragnarok, I felt, honestly, I felt the weight of God of War 2018 that I didn't feel the first time around. We didn't know that anyone would like this game. We didn't know people wouldn't hate the game. I mean, we were changing up the formula on a beloved franchise. So there was a sense of, I don't want to say pressure, because it was all internal. I wanted to write a score for Ragnarok that was as good or better than what I did for 2018. And so I think I just came to it with enthusiasm, but also this... This feeling of, I don't know. I was messing with something that was beloved. And if anything, I came to the philosophy that in order to make something great, we really had to evolve it. And there was some discussion in those early days about some of the musical themes being identical to what we had in 2018. And I reached a position where I didn't think they should be. I to me, a great sequel takes themes from the previous entry and evolves them. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. And I think that even as people start to hear the new main theme from God of War Ragnarok, which is a new version of Kratos's theme, I think they'll hear some very striking differences. And that was me embracing that the idea that in order for Ragnarok to be great, it can't just be a rehash of God of War 2018. That was scary. And, you know, we'll see if that was the right thing to do. We'll see if fans like my music as much as they like the last one.
And that's the thing. We actually, after you head out for the day, which won't be for a little bit, we're actually going to play the main theme on here for everybody in chat that's watching. And we're also going to play Svartalfheim, another theme as well. So stick around for that. But given to what you said, yeah, I mean, evolving that soundtrack must have been a difficult task. I feel like, you know, you could take the easy route and just copy paste everything that went right and everything that went well. But, you know, that's not the bare way.
There was definitely some discussion about doing that.
I'm sure.
And I understand it. Mm-hmm. One of the things, as you guys later on listen to the new God of War Ragnarok track, notice how the opening notes, bum, 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 notice how they make you feel this time around. Mm-hmm. See if, as it enters, as the track starts, if there's a different emotional context. And then another thing to listen for is that in the middle of what is essentially Kratos's theme, you hear two other themes. You actually will hear Ivor sing Memories of Mother, as in Faye's theme, and you will hear the Nordic folk instruments playing a new theme, Atreus's theme. And what that means to me is that this trio, this family unit, is now part of Kratos. He is inseparable from this woman and this boy, and that their DNA has been woven into his theme. It's a brief little moment, but it's different than last time. And I'm really excited about that. I think it tells you a little bit about where our story's going, and that Kratos is evolving, and that he's not the same person that he was in the last game.
Yeah. I think this evolution that you alluded to, sounds like we can expect some of that, a lot of that in the music as well, because, I'm wondering from an emotional context, right? There's obviously there's some new stuff happening in this sequel, right? There's the end of the world to think about, right? The Ragnarok, if you will. From that transition from the first game to this game, what emotional context did you get this time around? Did once again you meet with the team and get the whole story low down so you had an idea of where to take your ideas?
Yeah, this began with me sitting down and talking with the team again. Mm-hmm. They sent me the script, which in my memory was like 800 pages. the way the game scripts work, there's sort of like every alternate branch is represented.
Right.
But also it's a big story. There's a lot happening. But I remember reading it in one sitting and weeping truly at the end. I remember tears pouring down my face, and I couldn't believe that I would get to write music for these moments that were coming. And I felt as a fan that I was getting a little of what I wanted and everything that I needed. It was everything that I had hoped for, and then all these wonderful extra things that that inspired me. So it was great to start in that place, and just feeling like starting with this feeling that I'm inspired, and that melodies are coming, and taking melodies that existed and putting a new spin on them. There were also characters that just needed new themes. There were characters that didn't get themes last time. I already mentioned Atreus. I mean, that's a big one.
Yeah.
He didn't have a theme in the first game because he's in this tug of war. Is he like his mom? Is he like his dad? Ultimately, the game is about who he is, but he doesn't discover who he is until the very, very, very end. There really wasn't a purpose in him having a theme because you'd never hear it. It was this one or that one, a binary. Mm-hmm. Now it's like a triangle. He's a teenager. He's come into his own. We see this in the trailers. We see this in the opening 3 minutes of the game. So he has his own theme this time around. And now it's like this triangle, which was something that as I read the script, I realized was an exciting opportunity. But I got to say, writing a theme for Atreus, that was maybe the biggest challenge of all. That was the most intimidating. That was the most intimidating experience I had.
Yeah, it sounds like a tough thing to do when you combine his mother and Kratos as two completely separate entities, and you've already created these narratives for these two completely different people, and now you gotta somehow sandwich them together but make it different but make it similar. It's probably a lot. I'm really looking forward to listening to that theme in particular. Somebody in chat by the name of Poseidon, thank you for gracing us with your presence, Poseidon, has
all hail Poseidon,
all hail to the seas, has asked what your favorite track was from 2018 God of War, but I'm going to ladder on top of that and ask you what your favorite track was from Ragnarok as well. So if you could give us your two favorites, if you have them.
Wow, that's tough. I mean, the main theme, God of War, is righteous. I mean, I think it's awesome. It's such a great tune. My personal favorite, though, and the one that I find I go to the most often, is Lullaby of the Giants. It's so unassuming and quiet. Ooh, it's just like, it has this weight. It's the theme that makes me realize that these realms all have a history. And the giants, of course, in our game have a very sad history. Mm-hmm. God of War Ragnarok, God, like, favorite theme, I don't know. I mean, I want to say God of War Ragnarok, my new spin on Kratos's theme is really cool. It's really cool. I wrote a theme for Anger Boda that is so cool and like childlike and light and ethereal. It takes us literally to another realm. We get another spin on Jotunheim and this place. I don't know. Atreus's theme is also really kick-ass. And I'm almost biased to pick it because I worked so hard on it. And it's got this connection to Kratos's theme where his theme is da-da-da. And Atreus's theme starts off with da-da-da, like just backwards. Da-da-da, da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da. Like I'm telling you twice, it's Kratos's son.
Wow.
I'm gonna go with Atreus's theme. I think it's called The Path of the Sun, if I'm not mistaken, on the record. But that was a cool. Oh, but then there was the dwarf theme. Oh, that was so cool. That one's in 7. I'm gonna give up. I give up. I don't know. I can't pick.
You gotta just listen to all of them, everybody. You can't get favorites over here. No.
Yeah.
So I also had a few questions about this before we wrap up, and a lot of people have been asking about Rings of Power in the chat too. And that's something else that you have been, you already worked on, and it's been coming out and everybody's been really happy to hear the music. Talk to me about working on Rings of Power in addition to all these other projects that you've been on.
I mean, I've been a fan of Lord of the Rings my entire life. It's a dream come true to be able to be involved in the telling of the second age of Middle Earth, which is the preamble to the Peter Jackson Lord of the Rings films. It's interesting because I feel like my love of Lord of the Rings as a vibe was an influence on my work for God of War and God of War Ragnarok. And I mean, it's to me inevitable that there's some bleed over. I mean, I wrote a theme called Khazad-dûm for the dwarves in Rings of Power. Mm-hmm. And I've written for dwarves and their realm in Ragnarok. And I think they're very different. They're both drawing from the same kind of Scandinavian mythological view of dwarves. But there's definitely like a lot of connection there. I would say to fans of God of War Ragnarok, check out Rings of Power and check out that score. If you like God of War and vice versa, anybody who's watching because they like Rings of Power, you're going to love God of War. I mean, I think they're very different, but I feel honestly so lucky that I got to do both. I mean, I'm like pinching myself. It's a dream come true.
Yeah, super cool that I almost couldn't believe it when I heard you were announced as the composer for Rings of Power. I was like, what an amazing fit.
Well, I kind of felt the same way. And admittedly, when I wrote the music for the dwarves of Rings of Power, I just sat down and I was like, I mean, there was a lot to do and it was overwhelming. But I just thought with this one, the dwarf, mighty dwarf came. I just thought, I got this, man. Like, it's in my DNA, something about it. I'm a dwarf at heart. What can I say?
It also helps that you do look like you could live in the Lord of the Rings universe or the God of War universe. People have actually been drawing comparisons to the Nordic god Tyr. So,
I know.
Yeah. Have you ever thought of rebranding yourself as the God of Score by any chance?
Ooh, I haven't, but that's nice and modest. I like it.
Modest. Modesty is important, right?
It is. Yes. My middle name.
Bear Modesty. Bear, thanks for joining us. Just a few more things before you go. Are you currently working on anything that you can talk to us about? Because I know, you know, there's a lot of no talky-talky in the games and movie scoring realm, but are you working on anything that you can speak on?
The short answer is not really. There's a lot cooking right now. I am thrilled that Ragnarok's coming out. I just did a show called The Serpent Queen on Stars, which is this really cool historical drama that also kind of has this like contemporary fantasy edge. It's weird and cool. And I'm working on Foundation for Apple. We're working on a second season, which is a big sci-fi epic. And next year I'm going to be announcing some cool projects of my own that anybody that's into Lord of the Rings or into God of War, I think you're going to dig it. So keep an eye out on my social media for some news.
Cool. Well, Bear, thank you so much for joining us. I've had a great time talking with you, and Chad has loved you being here. So we would love to have you back anytime.
Awesome. Thanks.
Thank you.